待恢复个
Meeting resumes. Members asked for supplementary information from the administration on, well, they have given us two information papers. First is to address the issues raised. The administration has given us a response paper. Mr. Eamon Wright and Mr. Robert Probyn have already covered some of the issues, but there are still outstanding issues. I asked Mr. Wright to tell us about their response in reply to issues raised last time. The legal advisor has also asked some questions, waiting for answers from the administration. Let's hear from you so that members will have a full picture of all the responses and replies. Then members will take them all into account so that we will have a clear picture. Who is to start first? Mr. Probyn, you will give us a reply about questions raised last time from the Hong Kong MA.
Thank you. So I'll go briefly through the questions that were raised last time in turn. The first question requested a comparison on the implementation progress of the resolution regime and the corresponding LAC rules of Hong Kong with other major international financial markets. And because we've already covered that one, if there are no objections, I'll move on to the second question. The second question asked for the estimated interest rates of LAC instruments to be issued by local AIs, and particularly those without any single major shareholders, and details of studies conducted by the HKMA. We've already briefly touched on this as well. In a previous response, we explained that the interest rate we used was conservatively set at 4%, and this is set out in the final part of the consultation paper that we issued on the 17th of January, and a summary was subsequently published in the HKMA's half-yearly monetary and financial stability report in March this year. In determining the 4%, as previously discussed, this was obtained out of returns to a survey that the HKMA issued to all locally incorporated licensed bank, which led to this 4% calibration. Particularly on the question of whether banks that do not have a single major shareholder would also have to pay a similar interest rate on their instruments, it is acknowledged that they may in practice have a marginally higher rate, but because of the conservatism in our approach, we think that 4% remains a reasonable figure.
Okay.
The next question we were asked to address was, given the expected substantial amount of loss-absorbing capacity products to be issued by major banks in the mainland, we were asked for our assessment on the demand for LAC instruments to be issued by local AIs, and thus the cost impact on those AIs. I'd like to start off by referring members to the final section of the consultation paper we issued earlier this year, which specifically addressed these points, and just to bring out some of the key points. The substantial first point is that most AIs, which would potentially be in scope for issuing LAC, would in fact be required to do that by refinancing internal funding that is already in place within their relevant banking groups. And this is because the majority of entities potentially in scope of the LAC requirements are subsidiaries in Hong Kong of banking groups that are headquartered in other jurisdictions. This means that when these entities issue LAC instruments, they will be expected to issue instruments internally within their groups up to their parents, as and when their parents then issue loss-absorbing capacity instruments. Mm-hmm. Those will be issued into global markets, which will likely be already familiar with the names and products issued by those groups. And it is well known that there is already a deep global market for these types of instruments, because many of the world's biggest banks have already, for a number of years, been issuing such instruments into those markets, including in some cases, to finance their Hong Kong operations. Mm-hmm. However, we do acknowledge that there will be a few locally incorporated licensed banks, potentially covered by the LAC rules, who would be required to issue instruments and that do not have overseas parents. Our view remains that we do not see any particular issue around market capacity for such instruments for a number of reasons. I've listed half a dozen here. I'll just go through them very quickly. So one is that all relevant entities will already be issuing into the debt markets to some extent through the issuance of debt capital instruments. And while LAC instruments are not necessarily the same, it would be open to such entities to issue more capital instruments if, understandably, they chose to issue non-capital LAC debt, which would be expected to be cheaper. Their names and their investor base would nonetheless be something they would be able to leverage in doing so. In relation to the potential issuance of loss-absorbing capacity instruments by mainland banks, the lead time provided for in the LAC rules of 24 months, subject to the further latitude which my colleague has already discussed in terms of pushing back timeline, would provide issuing entities in Hong Kong with increased ability to optimize the date of the issuance of their own instruments. In addition, we would not necessarily expect the investor base for Chinese G-SIBs to be the same as for locally incorporated AIs. In particular, Chinese G-SIBs typically currently issue bank debt to a domestic investor base. And so we would not expect there to be necessarily direct competition amongst investors, for investors, between LAC issued by local entities in Hong Kong and Chinese G-SIBs. It's also helpful to point out that there is no requirement in the rules or in the code of practice that any LAC issues, any LAC instruments be denominated in Hong Kong dollars, governed by Hong Kong law, or issued in Hong Kong. So as a result, where locally incorporated AIs think that it would be optimal to do so, it will be totally open to them to seek investors in other markets. And finally, just to emphasize the point that there is already a developed global investor base for these types of investments. So notwithstanding the above, it's not possible to predict how market conditions will develop over time. And this is where the fact that the MA is able to provide more time, if necessary, to allow AIs adequate potential to access markets comes in useful. And as we've previously discussed, the MA can do this both by deferring the classification of an entity and then by granting more time for LAC requirements to be met. Finally, in the points coming out of the last meeting, the HKMA was asked to consider some members' suggestions of allowing an AI to use part of its assets for meeting the capital adequacy ratio to fulfill the minimum external LAC requirement. The key point to make here is that the rules do allow for exactly this. The main constituent parts of external loss-absorbing capacity and internal loss-absorbing capacity are expected to be capital, and the rules specifically allow for most capital to contribute towards the meeting of LAC requirements. The one exception is that it is not expected that where capital counts towards LAC requirements, it would also be able to count towards regulatory capital buffers. And that is because those buffers are not hard requirements, and they're designed to be able to be used by AIs without them going into resolution. So that's a run through of some of the questions that were raised in the previous subcommittee meeting. Shall I move straight on to questions raised by the Legal Services Division?
We stop here first to see whether our members have you know, follow-up questions on the answer. Tan Kien Po, 議員,
好啊,
Mr. Chen Kien Po.
Let me put a question first. According to the MA, the non-capital instrument, the rate is 4%. I hope that the Hong Kong MA would have regard to Hong Kong situation, the interest rate hike globally. Would they reassess this and make it 5% or a higher rate? As mentioned by the deputations, if they insist on 4, would they explain why 4? Hong Kong MA, please.
Just to clarify, the 4% is not a number that is set or calibrated by the HKMA. This was our estimate in the cost-benefit analysis we did of the rate that in practice AIs would have to pay to the market in order to issue LAC instruments. Of course, going forward over time, as the macroeconomic environment continues to evolve, it might be that AIs have to pay higher or lower interest rates in order to raise funding. I think the one point I would make is that, generally speaking, in a macroeconomic environment which sees higher interest rates, that sort of environment, yes, it is quite likely that banks may have to pay more in order to issue their own funding. But in that environment, typically, we expect banks to have more opportunities to raise revenues and increase profits.
Chairman, Mr. Chen, well, they use the 2017 figures. The banks made it very clear that it will not be any lower than 4%. It must be higher than 4%. Some even mentioned 7, 8%. I'm not sure which one is true. I'm grateful to you, Chairman. A lot of questions have been addressed in writing. Would they tell us in writing the regulators globally, how did they define the resolution institutions? In Japan and the US, they only deal with G-SIP and D-SIP. Are there any jurisdictions that deal with any other institutions other than D-SIP and G-SIP? To me, the US and the UK, Japan, they only deal with G-SIP and D-SIP. Now, they said that this is one of the considerations. Even the $150 billion is the starting point. I hope that they would explain in greater detail in writing. Okay, other than Mr. Chen Kin Po's question, and he's calling for a reply, a response in writing. Any further points that members like to make? If not, legal advisor. Will you please take us through the points you raised? The administration has responded to some of the legal questions yesterday. I don't propose to read out the questions one by one. Having read the reply, perhaps I'd like to state some of my concerns. Point 7, under regulation, under Rule 3, the resolution authority can, by written notice, serve a classifiable entity identifying a preferred resolution strategy to cover the entity. In my letter, I asked the question whether some explanation will be given about the grounds regarding the strategy that you identify, and also will the entity be allowed to make a written representation. I saw from the reply that LegCo, in the process of scrutinizing FIRO, has accepted that the decision of initiating resolution on a particular entity under FIRO is not a decision that is reviewable by the RRT. From the legal point of view, we have to consider the due process. This decision is a significant decision because you identify a strategy for a resolution institution, and they have to abide by all the rules and all the details. That if the aggrieved entity doesn't have the chance to make a written representation, then procedurally it might be suspect, it might give rise to unfairness procedurally. In your reply, you also mentioned that you have to consider the speed and flexibility. It should not be subject to any judicial action. In the regime, there is no procedure for review, and the aggrieved entity who may have any grievances may only go to JR or judicial review. If judicial review is to happen, it would lengthen the entire process. Then it is flying in the face of speed, and it would increase the costs and everything. So in the light of what I said, would you allow some procedures for an entity to have an opportunity to make representations to the RA to object to the terms or matters specified in the notice, or would you give any specific grounds regarding the decision? That's my comment. Right. I think this comment is similar to Mr. James Toh's comment. He made a similar point. So I'd like to hear from you about the your reply.
Thank you for your question. I think the key point to make here is that the power that the resolution authority has to devise resolution strategies is not set out in the LAC rules. So it would not follow that the LAC rules should provide, for example, an opportunity for an AI to make representations or to be able to appeal to the Resolvability Review Tribunal in respect of a resolution strategy devised by the resolution authority. It's Section 13 of the FIRO where that power of the resolution authority is actually set out. And because the FIRO itself does not provide for a representation opportunity or an opportunity to appeal to the Resolvability Review Tribunal, it doesn't seem consistent to try now and put that into the LAC rules. So that's kind of the technical kind of legal response. But I guess we'd also like to offer a reassurance that in developing, that in doing resolution planning for an AI and in developing a resolution strategy, there will, as a matter of practice, be opportunities for AIs to interact and to feed into that process. So, for example, we have published a code of practice chapter which allows us to require AIs to submit information to the HKMA, and when they do that, they have an opportunity to, for example, make proposals around an appropriate strategy.
And just to add briefly to that, our experience to date, where we have requested what we call a resolution strategy information requirement, the code of practice chapter that Mr. Probyn mentioned, is that AIs have indeed taken the opportunity to always express their preference for a preferred resolution strategy, and the MA has taken that into account when considering preferred resolution strategy decisions. So that's a very important place where we explicitly invite firms to express their views on the preferred strategy. And that's kind of how we work in practice, case by case. The resolution planning process is iterative. It's a dialogue with firms. We are working very closely together. But I don't think that should change the very important point that the FIRO sets out, which is very consistent with the international FSB key attributes, which makes clear that this is a judgment by the authorities. The resolution plan is the authority's plan rather than the firm's plan. So I think the legal position is well established and consistent with international norms, but we really benefit the dialogue that we have with firms and welcome their views.
Any further questions? No? No, Chairman? All right. No follow-up from the legal advisor. Anything else from the floor regarding the replies and also the legal advisor's questions? If not, everything that we meant to discuss today has been covered. We cover all the ground here. What remains are the questions that we raised. We'd like to have a reply in writing. Mr. Cheng Kin Bo would like the administration to tell us how the international jurisdictions define the resolution institutions. I hope that you would make available the replies in writing soon. We can't quite decide when we're going to meet next. Right. We have to make a report to the House Committee on Friday next. According to the Secretary, we have to make a report to the House next Friday. So we have to schedule the meeting next week. Next Tuesday morning, we have a meeting on taxation. Can we have an extension at House Committee? We have done so at the full council meeting. I've already extended this to the 12th of December. Mr. Christopher Jung, I think the administration can give a written reply to Mr. Chen and Mr. To. Can this be made available to me as well? Well, everybody would be on the distribution list. I'm thinking how much time the administration would need to make available a reply as soon as possible, Chairman. Friday today. Well, work is in hand, maybe. Monday, close of play. All right. We seek to have the meeting in the morning of Wednesday. We have a PWSC meeting. Some of the members are overlapping members, not all of us. And we allow you a little bit of time to play with. We seek to have the meeting on Wednesday morning, 8:30. Anything else from members? I think we have to have some discussions after the replies are given. You can seek further extension. No more extension, I'm afraid. Well, an extension has already happened, and that's the end of the legislative timetable. Of course, we understand Mr. Chen's concerns, and
咁當然，即係可能報告咗。
都要再開會，即係最壞嘅情況都可以係咁樣嘅嚇。即係內會係報告啫，可以報告話我哋仲喺度審議中嘅。係啊，好，咁啊，澄清咗個情況啦。咁我哋如果今日冇其他嘢咧，今日會議。Now
everything is clarified. We can try to make arrangements to have another discussion next week. Thank you.